I want to welcome everyone who's watching this session to the session. It's a great pleasure to be here because I think we are talking about one of the most topical topics that we could be at this time. CSR. And what should CSR be thinking about and doing as we move past the COVID phenomena, which is really active and at some level continue to be active, but beyond the here and now relief measures that people have been focusing on. And the reason why I say CSR is so important is corporates have a long history of actually helping the development sector. And after 2014, when it became mandated, you saw both an increase in magnitude, but I think what is also interesting was the increase in structure. And it really built on the whole idea of strategic, not just giving a bunch of random organizations, good organizations, money, but thinking about strategic areas. And therefore, how do you actually plan multi-year programs in those strategic areas, build capability, build depth of understanding? And I think that's why the session is so valuable, because while everybody has been focusing for the last 6 to 8 weeks on their immediate response to COVID, it's time to start thinking the next step forward. And for everyone, part of the journey is learning from others. And that's why I'm very glad that we have four experienced CSR professionals with us today who will share a bit on what they're thinking. And remember, like you and me, they don't know the answer. There's uncertainty. But what I've been really impressed with, I've had conversations with each of them before the session today, is that they have started thinking two steps ahead. And therefore, I'm going to actually structure this in a way where I will talk with each of them, get them to tell us a little bit about what their strategic sectors are and how they've been focusing on them, just a minute, then move on to the future. What are they looking at past this immediate COVID relief scenario? How are they thinking about COVID? Because that sets the context, we can't walk away from it. But also, how are they thinking about their strategic programs? And I've asked each of them to really focus on what is lessons and examples they can speak to us about. I also want to give a little context on CSR. While CSR has been a growing force over the last 5 years and has really stimulated, I think, some of the most innovative, interesting work in this space, there is a reality of today. Corporates have really come out to help everyone in this. And you can talk, you can see everybody talking about meals. You can see people talking about PPEs. There's definitely been a huge amount of relief. Also, corporates have given to PM CARES in a very big way. And given the way corporates are today, the funding for a lot of this has come from CSR. Not necessarily all the people we are speaking to today, but just in general, CSR has definitely taken the brunt of this. So the idea is, and we just as a bit of context, this is not just anecdotal. This is grounded in research. We spoke to 18 CSR heads and CEOs, as well as 22 NGOs, and can send anybody who's interested more data on this, but 30 to 60% reduction in CSR for traditional work. And it may actually be even more if one listens to some of the things that Devang is talking about. So that is the reality. Within this context, there are also opportunities and there are also smart ways of thinking about maintaining momentum. And that's basically what this session is about today. So with that, I'd like to welcome our four panelists. And I'm actually going to introduce them in the order in which we're going to have them speak. Ruchi Khemka of Deutsche Bank, Nidhi Pundhir of HCL Foundation, Devang Bhandari of KPMG, and Muluk Rastogi of ITC.
Mukul.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, all of you, for making time at such short notice. And I really must say, as I've said earlier, the conversations with each of you was fascinating. And I think the work you are doing is great for the rest of us to actually learn from and build on. So with that, I'm going to actually start. I'm going to start, as I mentioned, with Ruchi. And one second, I'm going to say, not talking here about the amazing work that Deutsche Bank has been doing in the here and now, but really talking one step in the future. As you start looking beyond lockdown and maybe the immediate sort of transition period, post lockdown, what are you thinking about? So Ruchi, what I'm going to actually ask you to do is first just give us an idea from Deutsche Bank. What are some of the core areas you've been focusing on as part of your CSR?
Okay. So at the outset, Ashish, Shiram, the entire Nudge team, thank you for putting this together. And for everyone else who's dialed in and listening, I hope you're safe in your comforts of your home with your families. So Ashish, coming to you, I've read the report that you put together as well, but coming to your question, so our classic three verticals where Deutsche Bank focuses on response to communities is in education, which is response to quality of education in the public economy school system. Healthcare, which is largely access to primary healthcare and corrective healthcare in you know, certain areas like pediatric cancer and people with various disabilities. And the third is access to water from livelihood perspective. So we work with various farmer communities across the country, in particularly in drought hit areas, to work on water for livelihoods as well as clean drinking water for communities.
Thank you. So with that, I think, as I remember in our conversation, you have been fortunate in that a lot of your CSR budget is still there. Very little of it has had to actually go for immediate relief. It's gone. Your support has been in other ways. So in that context, can you tell us of the remaining CSR budget that is there? How much of that is going to be geared towards COVID directly? How much of it is going to go to your traditional partners? Just top line.
Right. So to give you, you know, some numbers, we've currently committed about 20% of our entire annual budget on COVID already. And we're, I think, really preparing ourselves to put out another 10% if needed for further recovery and where the need really may be. But what that really means is, and Ashish, what I want to highlight is we aren't really looking at this as a cut for our traditional CSR projects or, you know, how we scale them down. I think we've taken a very, very innovative approach here as a management and, you know, with the entire CSR team on how do we work with nonprofits in a manner that we're helping them build capacity and thereby not really cutting out any of the budgets for them, but helping them work with the budgets that are available to strengthen them, one, on their strategy, on, you know, how the delivery will change and the entire cost optimization that will be needed for each of the CSR projects, given the timelines will differ, you know, through the year. So I think our approach hasn't really particularly been on, do we just give 70% of our budget to the NGOs that we work with to continue the projects? But I think it's about using that 70% effectively in a manner that results nearly into 100% to the support that we've been doing to these partners year on year.
So can you give us a couple of examples about that? And again, I'd like to break this up into two pieces. One is, there is pressure on trying to address what's going on with COVID. And you all are doing a phenomenal job in terms of direct giving for COVID, both immediately right now, and you're being pragmatic and putting another 10% away because things are potentially going to flare up in different areas. So is there a thinking about taking existing partners and adapting them to current COVID issues? If you can expand on any of that, if you're doing that with any of the partners right now?
Sure. So one, we're working with our existing partners. So, you know, we work with Akshay Patra, but that's really more on the COVID relief. I think the idea really is, and since you asked for an example, maybe I can cite you an example from one in the education sector. So we fund night schools with this organization called Masoom, who runs night schools in Mumbai, which essentially are for youth to attend class 8th, 9th or 10th in order to get a formal education 10th you know, certificate to better their career prospects. Now, in a classic education you know, sector, which you know, you would all agree, the delivery model currently is questioned itself. You know, there are no physical classes that are happening. Children aren't going to school. The schools are shut. There's a lot of lag in the education delivery itself right now. So I think the approach that we are taking is, one, to engage with your NGO partners really, really closely and understand, one, what the challenges are, and two, what the future lies for them. And I'll come back to that and explain, you know, in one certain case what we've done. Secondly, I think with COVID, we're not looking at this as an incremental, you know, it's an incremental support and not just substituting what you normally do with a traditional CSR. So you have to start looking at it as how do you incrementally support, you know, some of these systems. So with Masoom, for example, we're working on three areas, and so is with, you know, other NGOs. One is the delivery. Can we help them move to an online or a digital delivery, given that the entire model is around education. Two, the cost optimization. So I think with each of our NGOs, we're actually breaking down costs to say, what are your fixed costs that you know you will incur, whether it's infrastructure or salaries that you know you will incur on a month-on-month basis. But there's enough and more that's a variable cost, which links to the actual program delivery on the ground and which can become a question mark depending on when the programs will really resume in the normal scheme of things. And the third is on the strategy itself. You know, time and again, the more conversations I've had with my nonprofits in the last few months, we've realized how they're struggling with their own the survival, given this whole work from home, you know, their MIS and, you know, managing their teams and in a virtual space. So to give you an example on each one of them, I think there's a very big, you know, area of optimizing costs for your programs. There will be delays in the programs. There will be costs that, you know, may not be incurred through the year, and those could be worked out. Secondly, on your delivery, again, as volunteers from Deutsche Bank, we're now looking at ways of helping them build out the technology and MIS in a way that they'll be able to monitor their impact or monitor, you know, build tools to monitor their programs in a better manner. And three, from a strategy perspective, again, our volunteers are working with them to see, can we help them strengthen their processes, whether it's their HR practices or processes or their technology needs again. Essentially, volunteers to come together and say, for an education vertical, can you record some videos and send it out from a change the delivery model to a WhatsApp or a Zoom class for the children to continue learning? So I think the idea here is, how do you engage and talk to your NGOs on a continuous basis instead of looking at ways on whether you're really, we're not looking at trimming any projects here, but we're looking at building capacity and helping them so that they're stronger and they, you know, continue to work on the programs that they run in a post-COVID environment.
Ruchi, that's fascinating. Let me ask a couple more questions around this. So there's been a lot of talk about actually strengthening capacity, and whether that's through other ways of delivery, whether it's really looking hard-nosed at, from a planning perspective, what are your actual fixed costs? And what I really liked was you put salaries under fixed costs, which they are. They're not dispensable. And for every NGO who knows that and knows sort of today, the biggest problem is, how do I even keep my team in place? So I'm presuming you're sending out a clear signal to your strategic nonprofit partners that salaries are fixed cost and you will try to help them maintain that. Is that correct?
Absolutely. You got that right. Absolutely right. In fact, there are projects where we run where most part of our support is only supporting salaries for staff and special educators who work with children or youth with disabilities. So absolutely, salaries are a fixed cost.
Good. So I think that's a good message to sort of make sure comes across. The second thing I wanted to just ask you to expand a little, you kept talking about building capability. You talked about MIS systems, etc., and you kept talking about volunteers. Could you tell us a little bit, what does that mean? Was that actually your teams going out and building MISs? Was it your, if you could just tell us a little more about that, I think again, it would be useful.
Sure. So to give you two examples on, again, you know, one with Masum and maybe with one other program. So there are multiple things that we're doing and engaging with our NGOs right now. So when I talk about the MIS, it's actually the technology team within Deutsche Bank who is working alongside with the NGOs, identifying what their challenges are with technology, whether it means how do they put their MIS together. The teams are all apart. Not everyone has, you know, a computer maybe handy, but, you know, is there a way of effectively putting together, monitoring the data that is there on the field with the field staff, either using your phone, transferring that into an MIS, which is actually legible and, you know, is corrigible data that can be used. So the tech team works, and we use those hours as volunteering hours when they come ahead and spend that time working with the NGO on their needs, or working out on simple Excel sheets that, you know, the NGOs can use to monitor, or working on simple presentations, you know, that they can help with. And secondly, on, you know, like I said, keeping the NGO staff also motivated through various workshops that we're doing. So, you know, I conducted this one workshop for Agastya, which is one of the other nonprofits that we support, yesterday, on simple things like donor management. You know, how do you talk to your donors in the post-COVID environment? What kind of decks do you have? How do you send out your impact studies to them? And they are using this time currently, because the ones who are not working on COVID relief or recovery actually are spending some time, and we're spending some time with them to build their capacities and capabilities into building processes. Another NGO we're working on to say, can we continue to work with your youth on one mentoring? So our volunteers today are engaging with them on a weekly mentoring class that is taken with a very structured way of, you know, an 8-week module that will be taken, right from talking to them about how they feel about their mental health to their career opportunities. Secondly, recording sessions on math, science, English, and other regional languages, and sharing again with the children in the older classes and the youth via either WhatsApp or Zoom classes. So these are some of the ways where I think we're going beyond, one, the classic CSR of giving money, and, you know, two, a classic volunteering, but actually trying to add value and support and build that capacity on the ground for our NGOs by stepping in.
Thanks. That's very helpful to understand the level of depth into which you're actually getting and how you're thinking about this. Thank you, Ruchi. I'm going to move on now to Nidhi and ask Nidhi to tell us a little bit about how they are thinking about this at the HCL Foundation. Nidhi, welcome. Glad to have you here today. As I said earlier, the focus of today is not on HCL Foundation's immediate work in COVID, which has been phenomenal. And just for the audience, I do want to say some of the things that Nidhi was telling me about the way they've turned over call centers to actually work on helplines, the way the broader group, et cetera, has put in money so that the CSR money can be protected for traditional programs. It's amazing to see what HCL has done. But I'm going to focus on this session a little bit more about your strategic areas of interest. What have they been? And then talk a little bit about what does that mean as you move forward in a COVID world? How are those being adapted potentially for being more effective at supporting COVID recovery? And B, for those programs themselves, how do you maintain momentum with everything else going on? So let me start with the first one. If you can tell us a little bit right now about your strategic areas of focus, that'll be a great start, Nidhi.
Right. Thank you so much, Ashish. And it was such a pleasure hearing you out, Ruchi, earlier. Again, you know, the times have been tough, and it's not a regular kind of emergency. While most of us, you know, who are in development space, we've dealt with humanitarian action before. So I would say that at HCL Foundation, we were slightly fortunate that we already had DRR as one of the areas. And by DRR, I mean disaster risk reduction and response, which we have been working quite methodically even before COVID. So as a part of the strategy, this was quite clear that as and when there would be a disaster anywhere in the country, we would be available not only to support in terms of relief, but how we have taken the approach is always has been that of relief, restoration, and build back. So those are very clear strategic, I would say, pre-COVID, way before COVID, you know, 4 years ago, we got it in our own trust deed and, you know, got our staff trained on even thinking like that. And that has also been one of the criteria in partner selection. By and large, most of our partners would have DRR as their mandate. So I would say that it was a quick turnaround as early as March. Not that, you know, all HCL Foundation programs are, implemented in partnership with NGOs. Essentially, we do have a big share of direct programs also, where the team is employed on ground. Of course, lockdowns impacted. It's not that, I mean, let's be truthful that, when we all had to combat the pandemic and the only big strategy was to be locked down, we were with nation and everything. The first message went out from my desk to all the partners that let us be completely in adherence to the state regulations. And that's the big strategy. And we gave clear comforting messages that, you know, in these times, let's take this time to pause and introspect and reflect. Fortunately, it was March, the month of March, when we anyways do our compilation of reports and document and, you know, do our financial compliances, etc. So it gave some good time, a breather to all our partners, to all our team members, to also completely reflect upon how the year went by. And in those lockdown moments, of course, I saw huge solidarity happening. So some of the key areas where we have re-strategized, I would say, is training capacity building, awareness and coordination, which we have taken clearly in our relief kit, wherever coordination communication could be improvised through various platforms and using technology in a big way. Of course, complementing the healthcare, including safety measures which were needed for the staff on ground, etc. But most importantly, the larger behavioral change which has to happen. Food security is another area which we have taken quite seriously, especially for the most vulnerable groups, including children. Care for most vulnerable groups, again, including elderly, and animal welfare. So this is, I would say, with regards to COVID-19, the realignment of strategy. But as HCL Foundation, in broad areas, we've always been working on education, livelihood, skill development, health, environment, and disaster risk reduction. But all the five themes actually took an emergencies mode. So we just added the word education in emergencies, health in emergencies, livelihood and skill development in emergencies, environment in emergencies, because relief is of course 20 to 30%, which is bound to happen. We got to do that. But then restoration and build back is where we are focused currently, along with our partners. So just to answer your first question in terms of the thematic areas.
So if you think about those five areas, education, livelihoods and scaling, health and environment and risk reduction, and now in the context of COVID, first of all, you said that you are realigning strategies. Could you give us for one area, for example, and you can take any area you want, how is the work that the organizations are doing on the ground changing specifically? And I'm breaking out the difference between addressing COVID versus working in the world of COVID. So when I say working in the world of COVID is the classic social distancing, etc. Addressing COVID is saying I'm actually changing what I'm doing to address problems that have come out of COVID. If you can give us both those, one is sort of what am I doing different to actually address the problems coming out of COVID, that would be amazing. And then we can go on to how do I live in the world of COVID.
Right. So again, early March, I would say the beginning of the larger pandemic in India. And that was the time we took, by and large, 1 or 2 weeks to just think about it and approach it systematically. Of course, the relief part took over a lot of our time, and we established a very coordinated task force, both at the group level as well as at the HCL Foundation level. Which began to come together on a daily basis and looking at the situation and how the curve is moving. Good part was that we knew from other countries what's coming. So it kind of gave you some preparedness time. Another thing I would say, the coordination with state, which has always been, COVID pandemic is coming, is state-led. Very clearly it's state-led, and we've seen the strength of the nation coming together in this pandemic. So what we essentially did, and let me take an example, concrete example from healthcare, and we work with more than 160 NGO partners. So I would compliment all of them how they kind of, in one of our urban community development programs, then we have another program called HCL Grant. There also we have NGO partners. And then we have rural development program called Samudai, where teams are deployed directly on field. So what actually came quite, I would say, to advantage was this whole memorandum of understanding that we've always had with state. Be it any program, there has always been pre-COVID, I would say, a part of our strategy where we always formally got into a signed MOU with government and necessarily, I would say, assess the gaps together. And then we began to work where government and us were complementing each other rather than duplicating the efforts. And that's been a part of the philosophy and the principles. So again, to go back to maybe, let me take a quick example from family planning services, which, family planning program, the reproductive health program, which has been going on in almost all communities where our projects are across the country. Nothing actually stopped for very long. 1 or 2 weeks, I am saying again, disruption happened. But that disruption was for thinking, that disruption was for re-engineering, redesigning, cajoling ourselves, district administration was quite busy, and of course some of the programs lost a bit of continuity, but partners came back with enthusiasm, and then we were able to touch base with AAAs, the ASHA workers, Anganwaris, ANMs. We've been able to work through the district administration, and since there was this whole trust factor at the DM level, at the SDM level, and their teams level, and our teams knew them. So while we created the back end system, they were at the front end. So in cooperation and collaboration, you know, be it supplies of contraception, be it menstrual hygiene, the behavioral change. One part which we must acknowledge that we live in the world where we don't have a digital equality, or not everybody has devices. So what we started to do was also we started to track, which we were already doing as a part of our earlier program, where we were looking at technology, as an access issue, which is also a mandate that we are taking that, it should be a rights issue now. It should be as accessible as water to everyone, but then unfortunately, the children we work with, or youth we work with, or parents or farmers we work with, essentially don't have access to devices. And at that stage, we kind of started to track back, but as much as possible, I think it's 30 to 40% beneficiaries which are back in radar. And the ones who don't have, through community circles, somehow we've been able to touch base. So health programs definitely had to be rebooted in the interest of pregnant mothers, lactating children, adolescent girls, the menstrual hygiene issues. Education and emergencies mode also we took in education, I would say, where the modules were very soon crafted and we started to deliver them back to children, especially in exam time. But I must say that education of children is hampered to a great extent, especially for the ones who don't have devices. And that's where our efforts are, to get maximum internet packages and devices. How do we do that? And that's where we'll gear our programs. Mental health, psychosocial health. So we had a range of partners who work, starting from Banyan and Selamuthu Trust, and Vim has. There's a whole range of partners who work on psychosocial health, and this was the time where their programs only got enriched, because they already had tools, they already had ways of measuring resilience as well as working on resilience. And one part which I must mention here, which came quite handy, that we had always been consolidating the learnings which were coming from partners or community participants in the form of an academic initiative at HCL Foundation, which many of you are aware of, HCL Foundation Academy. So that just got completely, rebooted in these times, and all the sessions came alive on HCL Foundation Academy. I mean, every day we have, connecting back with the beneficiaries as well as network, very interesting sessions, and certain courses are running there. So partners who were not able to kind of reboot or re-engineer the programs, that platform was always available for them. So I would say that from 30% efficiency to 40% to 50% program efficiency to 60%, I think every day is seeing progress. And we are quite optimistic that the way the coordination and collaboration is going on, we would be able to reboot to quite an extent. But yes, there are limitations of not meeting people, migration happening from urban areas at such a massive scale. There are high level of unmet needs which we are evaluating along with our partners, and we are re-engineering the programs, to be honest.
Nidhi, so if I want to just summarize a couple of key points that you've made, which I think are important. One is you're continuing to focus the CSR efforts on strategic areas. And that has two parts to it. One is areas like family planning, etc. The problems haven't gone away. What's really happened is the delivery models may not be working exactly the same way. So you work with your partners to actually change or adapt the delivery models, but it's still fundamentally the same thing. It's getting contraceptives to them, menstrual hygiene, you're still focusing on the same thing, just a change in the model of delivery where you actually worked with them and supported them. And the second is you're saying there are areas popping up of need which may not have been normally thought related, like mental health. And there you're actually ramping up the partners and getting them to actually focus on it. Would that be a quick summary of sort of the kinds of ways you're thinking? I'm again just trying to make it very concrete for people in the audience. Thank you. In the interest of time, I am going to move now on to Devang and ask him the same question. So first thing, Devang, just if you can tell us, what are the strategic areas of focus of KPMG?
Sure, Ashish. Thank you very much. Hearty welcome to all, and hope you all guys are safe and healthy. I guess from a KPMG perspective, we obviously have a bias to intellectual capital, which is why our global focus is SDG 4, which is the quality education. But from an India perspective, I think that is a much broader spectrum we look at, right? From early childhood to secondary, primary, and secondary school, as well as skilling. Also it includes entrepreneurship as well. So that sort of is a holistic focus. We sort of look across spectrum from a skilling, education, and development perspective.
Sorry, Devang, we've lost you, I think.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we can hear you again.
Okay. Yes, as I was sort of summarizing that, from our focus perspective, we've got a biased intellectual capital, and we focus on SDG 4 from a quality education perspective. But from an India standpoint, our focus is sort of expansive in that area. We look at from early childhood to primary and secondary education, as well as youth development, as well as skilling and so forth. So I think the entire spectrum is what we look at across education. So that's our focus.
Great. So if you think of the path forward and your areas of focus, again, I'm breaking this up into two buckets. There's things which are actually trying to directly address the challenges raised by COVID. And then there are the strategic areas you've been focused on, and how do you adapt them to the current COVID context? Could you give us a little idea how much of your effort is going on the first one, that is actual problems of COVID that you're directly trying to address? And the second is taking what you have and how do you actually maximize the strategic focus given the context of COVID?
Yeah, sure.
Start to the first one.
Sure.
Just first a broad effort, how much effort is going into each of these? Funding, sure. Your own time, et cetera.
Sure. So I think on the first question, right, I think, again, just to summarize, as Ruchi was mentioning from Deutsche Bank perspective as well, I think similar situation for us. So far, we've spent about 20% of our funds into the direct COVID relief activities. And I think that sort of is one part, which is immediate response. And of course, our employer at our employee level have also done a lot of payroll giving and so forth. That's obviously over and above what we've put from a CSR perspective. So that's one aspect. Now, which means about 80% of our funding right now will go into our strategic areas. And I think one of the points I do want to drive here is, as you rightly said, we are going to live in a COVID world. So there is no post-COVID for me. Quite honestly, it is living in this new norm is what's going to be. So for us, the 80% which goes into our strategic areas, we'll have to figure out how do we sort of modify the current ways of working and the current ways, the way we reach out to beneficiaries, and adapt that to the new COVID scenario. Now, so I'll take some examples. One I think is I sort of call it as C2C, which is classroom to community. So one of the NGO partners we're working with, to start with, it started like as a relief, COVID relief or a response perspective, which is, this NGO which we support, the kids actually typically come from daily wage earners. So clearly it's just not the kids, but their community has also been impacted and so forth. So for us, to take our effort from classroom to community was very important. And the immediate response was to say, okay, we want to make sure that every student, every beneficiary which we support through the NGO, their families are sort of also, you know, being addressed, and their needs are being catered to. So the immediate response was to get them the, you know, the food ration and so forth and all of that. But now, while that was going on, I think now we're trying to figure out and work with our NGO partners is really around, okay, how do we sort of extend this effort in this new world and really think about community perspective, what can we do differently going forward? So it changes forever in terms of the way we sort of work with our students. And I think that will become very, very crucial. Nidhi pointed out around, you know, the digital access. Clearly, it's a very, very key issue for us as well. You know, one of the NGO, you know, one of the partners we support, you know, luckily they have embedded tablets as part of their education, and the kids sort of get tablets and they sort of learn through that. But it's part of that. But the point again is that they may not have access to tablets at home. So I think for us to try and figure out, you know, when we talk about online offline delivery, you know, the beneficiaries we are working with are in a very dire state. So for them to get digital access is something, you know, is quite difficult. So that's another area we're trying to figure out, okay, how do we make sure that we support our NGO partners in a way that we can at least get to this offline online model, but with a proper sustainable support structure. So that's, I think, the second element. Third element, I'll give you an interesting example where we were actually looking to support one of our existing NGOs was to building a school in Haryana in one of the villages. But now this entire construct of the school and how the school is going to be developed or what the education model is going to be is completely under a new scanner altogether, given that where we are, you know, so it's not going to be a traditional school as we thought it would be pre-COVID. So that's, I think, another example. And then I think I'll give you one more example, which again brings to the point why we need to live with this COVID scenario. So we support, youth, 18 years, so between 15 to 18, 19 year old, who've been severe, you know, because of the harsh environment, they've been in dire situation. And so there's an NGO which sort of, you know, brings them in, they'll sort of, you know, do the entire, it's about a 1 year program, actually spends even, you know, it goes beyond a year, where the first 6 months, they're only focusing on building their confidence, building, you know, working on the mental health and so forth. And then gradually figuring out what are the interest areas, get them to do those technology courses or whatever the courses they're interested in, and then get them to sort of get deployed in the, you know, go back, deploy in the from employment perspective, and make sure that they continue to stay in that zone and never sort of come back to where they were. Now, in a COVID scenario, in the current scenario, you know, and this was a residential program, the point is, we can't just turn our backs and say, look, you know, we COVID and we can't take the risk of not having these folks, you know, because they all live together and they don't have otherwise places to live. So we'll have to actually ensure that they come back, number one. Number two is have adequate planning as far as emergency response from medical perspective. Again, living in the COVID world and say, okay, what if this happens, God forbid, then how do we support and so forth? So the point is not around turning our backs to it, but really around, okay, how do we support and strengthen this further? So I think those are some of the ways we are looking at from an existing, from an existing NGO perspective. And clearly with all my fellow panelists, I think we've talked about one assurance which has gone to all of them is like, look, right now we're going to make sure that you keep getting the fixed costs so that we continue to sort of evolve this model and there is no impact whatsoever from organization perspective, because as it is, the sector is quite starved for, you know, good people and so forth. So that's been a priority to ensure that they all have comfort from us, that there is going to be zero impact as far as their organization is concerned.
Devang, that was extremely interesting and thoughtful. And I just want to ask a couple of questions if we go deeper. So for example, you were talking of digital access and one of your partners actually having. So how do you handle that in a current situation where there is already starvation of funds? How do you actually help them get digital access to all the students? Sorry, I'm asking you a hard question, but those are the realities all of us are dealing with in this new world. Or even you were talking of the school and changing the design. If anything, you now need a bigger one because of social distancing. So if you can answer both. How did you actually get more access? And secondly, sort of on the school, what are the change you did in design? That would be interesting.
Yeah, so I think, definitely hard question. The second one clearly is something which is under development right now. So I'll have to be honest with you.
That's fine. If you haven't done it yet, but you're thinking of it, that's fine. Just want to raise, because those are the kinds of things that I think, frankly, for me, it's great to see somebody says, we don't know the answers, but we are thinking about them. That's fine. Yeah. That's part of what I think all of us are going through. So let's admit it.
Yeah.
I certainly don't have any answers. That's why you guys are here. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think the first one, right? I think the interesting thing, you know, again, we talked about some of the, there are certain newer models we are looking at. So there's one social enterprise looking to onboard, which is a lot more into peer-to-peer learning. And now the good news, at least for us, generally in India, is that the smartphone penetration is a lot higher than, you know, what it used to be a few years ago. So we're taking advantage of what's available to us right now. And it may not be extensive at this point because a smartphone can do only a little bit, but can we at least get started? Can we at least get our students get used to some of that learning digitally? So this peer-to-peer learning, so there's an interesting program which we are working with one of the NGOs, is where they bring in experts by different fields. So for example, talk about fitness as an example, right? So and again, the program is very much focused on ensuring how do we get 9th and 10th year old students to think about what is it that they really want to do, as opposed to, you know, traditional thing, okay, I want to try and do something in arts or science or whatnot, and then really don't, get the real benefit of what they might be able to do, so about their potential. So again, taking those as an example, we're trying to sort of bring experts onto those platforms, getting students across the board access to that WhatsApp group as an example. So WhatsApp is a very simple way of leveraging, giving them, themes and questions and exercises on WhatsApp. Then they come back and report on those. So that's how we're sort of trying to think about and, you know, extending our digital access to the, given the current constraint. Clearly, there's a lot more stuff to do as far as getting tablets access and all of that is concerned. So that's, I think, one angle. The other thing which I do want to sort of really bring out is the importance of partnerships from a CSR, from a NGO perspective. I think a lot of NGOs are very used to doing stuff by themselves, which is absolutely fair because they have a philosophy and so forth. But I think there are enough and more innovative models across depending on what other several social enterprises are doing, to say, how do we partner with them to see if we can actually bring that benefit to our beneficiaries, leveraging if there are certain innovations happening in the market, then can we build that? So for example, again, another example is, one of the NGO partners has created a very good program in Hindi, which you can just download on the phone and then play around with it. So can you get access to, so we're trying to actually push partnership through our way, saying, okay, this is what we see, you guys could connect. And not only just push, but we actually fund it. So just so that people can start to realize the importance of partnerships in this new world, and the new norm as we sort of, deal with the current constraints.
Thanks, Devang. That's very interesting. And I think the partnership theme is something that I like to sort of bring up when I close out the session. But I want to move on to Mukul, because I want to make sure, I know there's a bunch of interesting stuff going out there, and we have about 11 minutes left. And I want to make sure, Mukul, you get the right amount of time to talk about some of the work you've been doing, which is quite interesting. So I'm going to welcome Mukul of ITC. And the first thing is just broad areas of focus, because they're very different from a lot of what the rest of us see in our day-to-day lives. So if you can give us an overview of that, Mukul, that'll be great.
Thank you, Ashish. So we have traditionally focused on two big areas, which is making today's livelihood sustainable and also focusing on healthy, skilled and educated workforce for tomorrow, which is what a lot of others have talked about. When we look at making today's livelihood sustainable, we are broadly looking at water stewardship. We look at social forestry. We look at sustainable agriculture. We look at livestock. And we look at women empowerment, because these are all the areas which our primary stakeholders, whether it's farmers, communities, need in case there is an issue which is climate related or anything. So making today's livelihood sustainable, these are the five things. The second thing that we drive is to say that today is fine, but how do we ensure that our HDI indices improve and that for tomorrow, we have a healthy, educated and skilled workforce. So here we focus on education. We look at skilling for youth. We look at solid waste management. We look at sanitation and we look at mother and child health. So this is the broad gamut of areas that we work in, Ashish. And we work across about 21 states in these teams. Yeah,
so that's a very, very broad gamut. Yeah. And I know that as a group, you all have done a lot in terms of immediate relief. And I'm afraid CSR has had to bear some of the cost of that. Yes, I'm not going to go into that. What I think is interesting is just thinking more about the future. And as you've been talking with all your partners and thinking about your core areas, if you can touch on both the topics, which is basically, if you see the consequences of COVID around you, how are people changing things to actually address those consequences? And the second is for the area that you've been investing in so long, how are you going to continue them? So I'm going to first ask that as you see the environment, you all are very rural focused. And that's part of what I meant by the difference of the world I see, at least. So what are some of the needs you're seeing and how are you getting your partners to change what they're doing to meet those needs?
See, I think in the post the immediate relief, there is a medium term issue, and I'm saying a short medium term. And that is about livelihoods, because a lot of people are returning back to their villages, having lost their jobs, whether it's the migrants, the daily wage workers from the urban areas. And they're not going to go back in a hurry. They're going to be there for some time because it's not been a pleasant experience this time. So what we're trying to say, and our government actually has announced a fair amount of schemes and funds which are available to these people. The challenge is that between the intent and announcements and actually what reaches the ground level, sometimes there's a gap because of lack of awareness, because of lack of being able to link these people. So the first thing that we thought of is that typically in the work that we do, whether it's agriculture or water and these areas, you know, because there were labor was not so much available, they had gone to the cities. We had traditionally looked at even machinery and technology, but this time we are saying when the migrant labor comes back, what can we do to link them to NREGA and use the NREGA funds also to do the work which we do in the thematic areas. You know, there's a lot of work which has happened to say who are these workers, who are the people who have job cards, who are registered under NREGA, can we get approval for certain amount of works in the catchments for NREGA so that these people thereafter can get linked to that. And thereafter, you know, and a fair amount of work has happened in our, one of our regions, about 2.5 crores worth of NREGA funds have been decided, allocated, and 18,000 man days of work has been allocated. And another, it's about 2.57 crores and man days they are yet to get back to us on work which has been identified. Thereafter, we because here, our job is much more of an enabler, of mobilizer, of doing the linkages so that these people who have come back, migrants or people in our catchment, get that benefit from the government announcements. So that's the first one. The second thing is that government has also announced several schemes. One is related to COVID and one is which were already there. So we are doing a very thorough assessment to see that in our catchments, because we are partners who are present, who are the people who we can ensure get access to the schemes that the government has announced for post, you know, for the 3 months or 4 months account COVID. And secondly, there were other schemes also. And this is because this is a stage where there may not be too much of direct active work happening on the thematic areas that we're talking about. Of course, I must say that thematic areas, which include watershed, agriculture, solid waste management, are all moving because they all help and livelihoods and, you know, generation of, not just generation of livelihood, but enhancements. They're all moving very, very well. Solid waste management is a regular essential service. That's moving very well. The only areas which have got a bit impacted would be where we believe that there are large congregations which are required, and second, where there's large amount of funding which is required, because reality is that about 40% of our funds have also gone into COVID relief, and there is a tightening up which is happening. So that was the first part, Ashish. I hope that answers your question.
No, that was very interesting and very helpful. Want to just go a little bit deeper into one or two of these areas, because I think you were talking about, first of all, what I understood was that a big way you're looking at it is you actually are on the ground and you have teams of your own also, and you have very good connections. So therefore, just from a needs of a community perspective, since there are government benefits that are there, let's make sure we actually get to them. So in some senses, it's actually restructuring what the NGOs are doing to meet the needs of today.
You know, I have to say that it has always been a focus, but now it's a little sharp because of the specific one.
Yeah, in fact, it's interesting. That's one theme I picked up from everyone, is adjusting what they were already doing at some level to go deeper, because the need has become larger at this time. So it's really need driving the change in what's going on. But I think that's one sort of very clear area that you're really focusing on, which is going in and saying, look, there is a need. There is already access to other people's resources. Everything doesn't have to come from you. How do you actually get more access to other people's resources?
Yes. And I think that links to the second point that you had, question that you had asked, which is to say, what is going to happen to your existing projects and the strategic things that we look at? So the one thing, of course, is that sustainable livelihoods today has always been a focus. So it's just that it's getting a little diversion. But just like all the other panelists, we've also had discussions with our 80 plus partners across the country. And in a fairly transparent manner, because there's been a long trusted relationship which has been in operation, to say, we are likely to see cuts this year. We are willing to support, and we'll do our best to support the manpower that you have. However, we do recommend a salary freeze. This is happening across all functions, many organizations, so it needs to happen here too. We will not be able to expand our work maybe this year unless we are able to get very strong fund leverage from either government or community. So we need to keep that absolutely on the radar. And exactly like what others said, what other costs can we revisit? So whether it is rentals associated to office space, can there be a moratorium on it for a couple of months with others? What is it that we can do? And of course, from our side, we've said that if we are tightening up the funds and still going to maintain and support your manpower cost, then the activity which we had planned is obviously likely to come down and become tighter, whether it is school infrastructure, whether it's farmer coverage or area coverage on the water or whatever else that we may have planned. But our attempt has been to talk to them, and very interesting ideas come up. So our partners have come up to say that, you know, we can look at rural livelihood missions. We can look at NULM. We can see if NABARD can fund. So there are many ideas which come when you engage in a discussion to say, we are in it together. This is a temporary, hopefully, issue. And in this period, the medium term, we are all willing to look at it. They've also looked at, and during this time, we've also worked very hard to see what can we do to be in a state of readiness for when things really open. So we have very, large partnerships with the government, exactly like HCL Foundation, Nidhi was talking about. And in these partnerships right now, some of them are amplification partnerships where we train the government officials and in turn cascade the work through them. And we are deliberating and discussing in many of these partnerships with the government to say, can we do it through Zoom? You know, because getting them together in a classroom may not happen for next 6 months or 8 months, which means the partnership deliverables will get impacted. So what is it that we can do, whether it is through Zoom, whether we can look at WhatsApp, or right now we've even sent some content to super trainers that we have in the system to say, you read up on it and then we do the Zoom call, so that we don't waste time and we are in a state of readiness. And this keeps our partners also busy. See, it's not just about us. if you're paying salaries for your partners, it is worthwhile for them also to do something, whether it's content readiness, whether it's online, whether it is looking at master data, you know, to see that which one of the beneficiaries are linked to schemes, what else can be done. These are the kind of works which are happening. And right now I would say that about more than 90% of our partners are already in the field and work is happening, maintaining all the government advisories on COVID, whether it's social distancing, whether it's ensuring sanitizers are present, all of that, yeah.
Thank you. So I just want to summarize a couple of, points. I'm going to take another 2 minutes because we've got to close up the session. But I think first of all is recognition that funding is going to go down and we don't need to debate the exact amount. But the whole focus here from everyone has been, we got to live with that and let's see what we make at the maximum. That doesn't become the focus of the conversation. But what do we do with what we have and maximize it? The second thing I'm seeing is a consistent theme. We've got to keep the capability and the people we've built. So find a way of supporting the staff, even if it does mean actually making trade-offs on programs, both on the extent and maybe even on the quality, but making sure we maintain core staff. The third thing is universally I've seen in most of all the conversations here is a focus on strategic areas. And I'd say there are three sort of sub themes within that. One is some areas have become even more relevant, like mental health. So it's a very natural to actually focus and double down on it. A second is where basically new needs are arriving, as Devang mentioned about the fact that you can't just go to the students, you also go to the community. So actually expanding longer term, getting to the community as part of what the student engagement is going to be. Or for example, as Mukul was talking right now about the fact that benefits are there. The NGOs have access. Can we actually help make sure the benefits get to the people we work with? So again, it's more around new needs and trying to see how to meet them. And then the third thing is recognizing for some of the NGOs, there are going to be challenges, there are going to be issues, and there's going to be a new norm of working and they may not be completely ready for it. So can one actually get one's hands dirty and help out with that? An example of that was actually Ruchi talking about their own tech team getting in and starting to work with the NGOs to help them. I can go on for quite a lot of time more, but I just want to stop at this and say that it's nice to see everybody thinking about life beyond, thinking about ways at what can be done and really maintaining core capabilities at a very, very intrinsic level. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish. Such a pleasure interacting with all of you. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.